I really want to stress the benefit of community journalism. It may not sound as sexy or as interesting, you know, to walk out of Ohio University and have your first J job be reporting from a local small town newspaper or website, but that's really the best way to develop your skills, to again build relationships, to build a great resume, and to have the tools that are out there right now in our world, everything from social media to our laptops and our tablets and our smartphones and other media devices that we have at our fingertips that can be translated from your local, you know, community to a global market of reporting or telling stories. People love to have their stories told, and one of the things that I really enjoy doing are profiles of people, and not just the big newsmakers, but the guy who owns the local business who has a very interesting story, or the war veterans. They all have a story to tell. People who are students, people who are teachers in the community. Everybody has something interesting to say, and there are people out there that want to hear it, but they need to have someone who shows that they really are interested, and they will speak to you, and it's a wonderful way to start your career in journalism. Patch has had we've taken its bumps along the way, and most recently, Patch is due to some, the business model and some profitability issues, they've scaled back somewhat. So what we've done is kind of regrouped and put our best resources in our towns that are the strongest. So in our markets where people really, really do rely on Patch. And I'm fortunate to live in one of those areas out in Northern California. So at this point, Patch is continuing to strengthen the markets that we're in. We're not growing and expanding into other markets yet. I do think that there will be partnerships, that Patch will partner up with other media companies eventually, and go off more maybe into video is becoming quite popular, so perhaps partnering with some more video type media sources. But I think that also Patch has really laid the groundwork, hence the name Patch, grassroots, for community journalism. So you may see more sites like this prop up, but I think we've really set the tone, and we've really laid the groundwork. It's taken a few years. It's taken some time for people to really latch on and understand that a community news website is a platform for others, for the community to take advantage of as well, and to participate in, and to blog, and to post their own content on there, so that really to bring the whole community, getting them talking to each other, which is the main goal of Patch, is to bring the community together. I was the eldest of the kids in my family, the first to go to college, so it was very eye-opening. It was great to just be away from a big family and be on my own, and I developed my interest for journalism in high school, so it was a great extension of that and a wonderful opportunity for me to have. I grew up in Columbus, and it was great to have a great journalism school, you know, within 100 miles of where I lived. And so to come here and just fall into this wonderful campus and meet all sorts of great professors and meet new friends, some of whom I'm still friends with today, and have great experiences and participated in all kinds of activities and campus intramural sports and professional journalism activities, and develop the friendships and have developed mentors through the different programs at the journalism school. It was great. My favorite was a guy named Mel Helitzer. Some may remember him. He was most widely known for being a humor writer, and he taught one of the years I was here it may have been 1980, I'm going to guess, 1980 or 81, he taught the very first humor writing class. So he was one of the first to tie in reporting and journalistic writing with humor. And for our final exam, we had to do a stand-up routine, and we did it in the Frontier Room of the old Baker Center. So that was a highlight. Another highlight is a woman that I still to this day remember, and that was Drew Riley Everts and her editing class. And the test that we would take, I think it was every Friday, and it was, I think she called them common knowledge tests or quizzes. These were things that everybody should know, just sort of random facts, but that you should know as a good editor. And we were graded on those, and it was just one of those things that made you realize how important every little day details are for a journalist, just to instant recall. And so those were two big memories for me. When I came into the School of Journalism, I knew my focus was going to be more on the creative end and the business end of journalism than on the strict reporting or broadcast journalism. I enjoyed and found that my talents more aligned with the advertising world. I do remember several of the copywriting classes that I took that were really wonderful in the development of the evolution of print advertising and how it started from copy and storyboards to the final product. After I graduated, I did some freelance work and eventually worked my way into a graphics design firm that published a magazine, and I would do various copywriting jobs for that magazine and for small ads. And I carried that into when I left for California in the early 90s. I was able to take that and develop that into some advertorial writing for a local newspaper in the San Francisco Bay Area. So then I went into news, and that was a little bit of it was sort of a natural progression in a way. And as I mentioned to the students, you know, once you can write, be a good writer, and have the tools that you learn here in the School of Journalism, regardless of what discipline you follow, you're learning some basic tools. Through my other work within my community, not necessarily my paid job, but my other volunteer jobs, either through schools or community government, I developed relationships and friendships with people, and then I could see where things were, sort of holes were needed to be filled in terms of communication, newsletters or articles that needed to be written. It just seemed like I always was the one that people would come to when something needed to be, an article needed to be written for a community newsletter or a city newsletter or a school newsletter. And so I started to slowly develop a reputation for that. And from there, I became a freelance writer for various media sources in the Bay Area. And that led me on to Patch. And so the reporting came sort of later in my life, later in my career, when I would be asked to go follow up on a city council meeting or a court hearing or talk to a police chief about a crime story. Kind of like riding a bike, you fall back on those initial tools of early journalism, the who, what, why, when, how, where. And you just start developing the stories. And of course, through Patch, I've been, you know, had lots of training and lots of colleagues that I work with and other editors, and we help develop each other's strengths. In between all of this, I wrote a city newsletter for the city of Belmont, in which I live, and that covered a little bit of everything from community news to city government to crime and police and fire. And so it was rather a work in progress. It contrasts because it's much broader, and you're not focusing. If you're at a city desk and you're maybe the metro editor or the crime editor, and you're sort of following a beat. So in this case, you're not really you need to be a little bit a little more broad in what you're able to cover and in the relationships that you build with people that are in the community or within the area that you're covering. So because you're the only person covering all of these various aspects, you may not necessarily become an expert in one area, but you are dipping your foot into many different aspects of covering a municipality, a city, or a, you know, a region. In my case, it's the San Francisco Bay Area peninsula. Some of the misconceptions are that that the people that are behind Patch are not professional journalists, and that it's something that was sort of put together rather rather quickly, and that it's run by people in the community who may not necessarily be employed by Patch, that are not necessarily professionals, and because it's so, it's such a unique platform, it's really never been done before. So to have people who come from all different types of journalistic backgrounds and come and focus on one particular area, one site, and do nothing but help write the story of that particular city, and then bringing in other people that are part of the community to help support that feeding that news through blogging or posting announcements or events or business listings. So the misconception is really that it's not being managed by professional journalists, and that it's just slapped together by people in the community. A really good day, first of all, is a busy news day. There are such things as slow news days. We do have certain goals that we need to meet as editors. We are a 24/7 news site, like most web-based news sites are. We theoretically, you could go onto the site any time of day or night and read. Now, that doesn't mean that we work 24/7, but we do post stories throughout the day. There is constantly new content coming in. On a good day, you will have a good mix of stories. So what we find is that people, and this is through various metrics that we do at Patch that we have internally that we can look at, we know certain things that people are very interested in, such as police and fire. Obituaries are huge. Business is huge. People in our communities love to learn about new businesses that are either opening or closing. School news is very big. So we a good day is when there's a nice mix of that stuff, and also when there's a, you know, kind of a big story. Oftentimes it will be something that will require continued reporting, follow-up stories. Whether it's some type of crime story or a big event, a big development event through the within the city, something that's controversial within the city that we can really report on from the ground level, and interview not just city officials but people in the community that are affected by it. And then also a nice mix of community events, things that are happening that that people rely on us to help promote and to help cover, whether it's local sports, a lost dog. Through Patch, we've reunited some dogs and their owners, and that's kind of nice. And it's also a good day is also when you can actually shut it off at night and know that you've got it all done, and you can safely walk away from it for a few hours and regroup, and know that when you come back, you can just pick up where you left off. Knowing what I know now, I definitely would have taken more writing classes, and I would have focused more on reporting and editing. Because the technology has changed so much, and I can't, there's nothing I can do about that now, but I think I would have become maybe, if I could do it again, become a little bit more technically oriented in terms of not just the equipment used, but the various services that are out there for reporting and for just overall telling the story. Because you have such a great opportunity here at Ohio University, and there's such a vast amount of classes, to touch on a little bit of everything, even if it means that you're not Don't just take what you need to graduate. Just jump into a few other things. Test yourself. Push yourself. Try something that you may not be comfortable with, because you might just find out that you like it. There's plenty of opportunity out in the big world to screw up things, you know, to try things and get them wrong. And while you're here, this is the time when you have these wonderful professors and wonderful mentors and grad students that are here to help you to jump in and take a class that may be completely something you never thought you would take it, but you're here. I wish I could come back and take a few more classes. I really do. Relationship building is huge in the world of journalism. Not just in developing sources for information, but building relationships also helps build the trust that you need to have with your audience. I also suggest, it sounds very basic, but never feel like it's good enough. Just keep editing, rewrite, read it again. Continue to practice writing. It's very basic. It sounds very simple, but it's so important. And as is reading, reading the work of other journalists, those that you admire, those that may be a little different than you. Some of my favorite things to read are sports stories, because I find that those who are sports reporters, especially the good ones, they're reporting really as it's happening. So if you can read the next morning, step by step, what happened in a game the night before, and have it be told in such a great way that's not just reporting scores, but telling the story of the game. I find that's a real gift to have, to be able to report something so fluently within a few hours. Other advice is, and this was advice that was given to me, it's better to be right than to be quick. So as much as we live in a 24/7 news cycle, don't try to beat out your competitors at the risk of being incorrect or not attributing to a source or getting a quote wrong. And don't ever be afraid to ask. Just people love to talk to you. They love to talk to journalists. Even if you don't think they do, they want their side of the story to be heard, and they want it to be told right. So don't be afraid to ask, and don't be afraid to ask people to repeat things. And in this 24/7 world, we tend to be very quick and think that we need to rush to get our stories out there, and that can oftentimes backfire on us. So be as thorough as you can, get it right. So it's been wonderful, and it's amazing how much I recall. I haven't been here since I had a brother that graduated in 1989. So it's been several years since I've been here, but it's amazing how a classic college campus remains the same and doesn't change all that much, although there are a few additions and a few modifications, but it's sort of like a dog finding its way back home. I mean, I managed to find my way to my freshman dorm and back up to Court Street and back over here to this building, and my family is with me, so it was great to show it to my husband and my kids. And my husband grew up the son of a professor, and so he's lived on many a college campus, and he was really very impressed, and we had a great day.